ओम जयति जगति मायां यस्य कायाधवस्ते वचनरचनमेकं केवलं चाकलय्य ध्रुवपदमपि यातो यत्कृपातो ध्रुवोऽयं सकलकुशलपात्रं ब्रह्मपुत्रं नतोऽस्मि। We who are keenly desirous of reaching perfection in life have come to Narada. We feel that it can be done through bhakti, but the bhakti which we have, we see that it is not able to make us reach perfection. So we have come to Narada. We know Narada learned his knowledge or bhakti from his guru Sanat Kumar, and is a capable teacher who has helped many people cross this ocean of Maya. And the brightest examples are Dhruva and Prahlad. So we have come to Narada to learn from him. And we are ready to change ourselves as guided by him. With this background, we have come to study the Narada Bhakti Sutras. And in this respect, I want to tell you something, that Narada is not divided into chapters and sections. The material which is in your hands, which the university has made available to everybody, is by this Swami Pitambarananda. Division, chapter, section, and the Hindi translation. But for those who wish to have an English translation in hand, I do not remember exactly the name of the author or the publisher, but I am telling you, there is an ashrama, not Ramakrishna Mission Ashrama in Karnataka, in a place called Shravana Belgod. Through internet you will be able to search it out. There was some Professor Sharma there who has done the translation, and this Sharma later on became, as much as I remember, a sannyasi named Sachidananda. I am giving you this information. And this English translation, compared to all other, let me tell you, even including Swami Tyageshwaranji, this is the best available English translation, except for two or three sutras, which when the time comes, if I get hold of my book, where it is hard to find out, I will tell you the correction. And in those two, three sutras, Tyageshwaranji's translation is better. This much information I am giving you now. Now coming back to the sutras, my friend, Swami Yogatmananji, at the end of the last class has suggested that there is a pathway. We were studying the second sutra yesterday, day before, and that second sutra we read was Sadhu Asmin Parama Prema Rupa. And we discussed Sadhu Asmin. We are yet to discuss Parama Prema Rupa. But Yogatmananji has suggested that there is a Patha Bhed. And the other reading is Kasmai. Instead of Asmin, it is Kasmin. Sadhu Kasmin Parama Prema Rupa. Now, Yogatmananji must be knowing that this Kasmin is not a question. Ka means Anandam. And Kasmin means in the Ananda Swarup Bhagavan. Our pull towards Ananda Swarup Bhagavan. But I tell Yogatmananda, if this Asmin is not accepted, 75% of Narada Bhakti Sutra charm is gone. And so, I in my humble way reject this pathway. and stick to Asmin. The main point in Narada Bhakti is that it is about the innermost reality. And the innermost is the dearmost. Innermost is the nearmost, nearest, and nearest is the dearest. I told you one day, please note down who have not noted. I am not putting the whole text of mantras, but I am giving you the reference only. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad 147 and 148. In 148, it is telling us that the best way to worship Brahman is by treating him as our Atman. And in the 148, how to worship Brahman as Atman, how to meditate on Brahman as Atman, what we have to think of this Atman, there he says, Atman is the dearest. Dearest is the word used there. So, Dva means Ananda Swarup, that is all right. But first it has to be Atman. It has to be our own reality. So, Asmin includes Kasmin. But Kasmin does not include Asmin. Anyway, with this explanation now, on Wednesday, we saw Narada, on behalf of so many gurus which he has mentioned in Sutra 83, is teaching us Atha Ato Bhaktim Vyakhyasyama. Now therefore we are propounding or enabling you to realize, experience what is real bhakti. Another thing which I told you here was, he has not given any qualificatory name to his bhakti. So, Dagesanji has called it Parabhakti. Everybody has called it something. Remember, Parabhakti comes at a very high point. What Narada is telling us is bhakti, which today, from here, up to the Brahmajna, up to the fulfillment of life, bhakti is a force. Bhakti is a pull. It will pull us from wherever we are. If we are on the right path, if we are on a side path, how to come to the right path? That he will show from Sutra 56. He will not exclude anybody. Anybody who is having a semblance of bhakti, of whatever type it may be, can come to the right path. Not that has to reach a particular stage. It is the Narada Bhakti Sutras which will enable us to get bhakti, that Narada is telling. No, enabling bhakti does not mean reaching a particular stage. There is a force going on. In English, we call it self-centripetence is Narada Bhakti. Self or the Atman or God in us is pulling us towards himself. That is the whole spiritual life. Whether you go to karma, jnana, bhakti or anything, our own real nature, which is Brahman or God, is pulling us, who are his shadows, towards himself to the center. Self-centripetence. That is the entire spiritual life. So, it is a force pulling all of us. If you had not the pull, why you have come to attend this lecture? If you had no pull, why did we join the Ramakrishna Mission? If you have no pull, why you have become associated with the Ramakrishna Mission? So, there is a pull in everybody. But the pull is not working 100%. Because we are little aside of the main road. We are on a side track. And so Narada told in the second. So first sutra is, Atha means at the psychological point, not a particular point in our life. when the sadhaka keenly desires fulfillment, he yearning to reach God, as just now said, to get freedom by going beyond the relative, when he feels that he can do it through bhakti and is ready to be guided by Narada, who successfully guided Prahlada and Dhruva, and is willing to change himself as guided by him at such a psychological point. So it does not speak of a particular high position, only he is ready to come on the main road from the sidetrack. And atha means therefore, hence. There are many tendencies appearing like bhakti, similar to bhakti, some percentage of bhakti in that, but they do not reach us to perfection. Hence, there is need of learning what real bhakti is. Right bhakti will surely help us to reach the goal. Hence, without getting fulfillment of life, the problems of life will not end. Hence, Narada finds himself capable of teaching it. Hence. So this is the meaning of atha and atha. Bhakti, as we said, is love and respect. Respect, not this formal respect, which is absolutely of no use in spiritual life. Respect is to understand that the thing which you are approaching, God, is the highest value in life. This is called respect. God is the highest value in life. That is called paying respect. And love is the pull towards him. So love and respect is normal meaning of bhakti. What real qualities we require more, that Narada will teach us. On behalf of all the acharyas, so he has used the plural vakyasyama. From there we went to the second sutra, and in the beginning Narada told us two. Let us take two first. Two, but keep aside your ideas of bhakti. Unless you keep aside your ideas of bhakti, you cannot catch what I am telling you. I am not rejecting your bhaktis. All your bhaktis, I will take up one by one and show how to come to their sidetracks, how to come to the main path, the force the bhakti is pulling us. After Sutra 56, from Sutra 56. But in the beginning, listen to me, what is real bhakti? So the only word I am able to use is real bhakti. And later on, in connection with, well, when it comes, you shall see. In the beginning, he is not giving any name to the bhakti because that is the only bhakti according to him. And so, sa means that bhakti which helped Dhruva and Prahlad to cross the ocean of life. That bhakti which I am going to teach you on behalf of all the acharyas is different from every other bhakti which you feel. That is the meaning of tu. Now, what are the specific points? So, the first point he deals with is asmin. Just now I told you, kasmin becomes included in asmin. But asmin is not included in kasmin. Asmin is the vital point of Narada Bhakti. Reality within. Asmin means toward this, not that. This means the nearest. This means the nearest. Nearest means our innermost reality. It is Ananda Swarupa by itself. So kasmin becomes included. But it has to be towards our own innermost reality. This does not preclude if that innermost reality is seen in some outside form. I gave Gopi's shloka for Shri Krishna that day. Nakalu Gopika Nandana Bhavan. अखिल देहिनाम अंतरात्मद्रि सख उद विघन सारथि तो विश्व गुप्त सख उदय इवान सात्वताम कुले फ्रॉम द गोपी गीता वी नो यू आर नॉट ए मैन वी नो यू आर द इनर मोस्ट नोअर ऑफ ऑल द पीपल हु लिव इन देयर बॉडीज इट इज अ डिफरेंट मैटर दैट ब्रह्मा रिक्वेस्टेड यू टू प्रोटेक्ट दिस वर्ल्ड एंड ओ डियर वन यू केम इन दिस पर्टिकुलर फैमिली दिस व्हाट द गोपीज टोल्ड So, I'll give another example. The great dramatist and whatnot, Girish Chandra Ghosh, said that Sri Ramakrishna loved me more than I can love myself. He's a dramatist. So his words are like that. Do you not understand that Sri Ramakrishna is the innermost reality? Because the whole life is getting pulled by the innermost reality. Sri Ramakrishna loved me more than I could love myself because I do not know what is my real goal of life. I do not know where my real benefit lies. He knows. So he has loved me more than I myself. So the first vital point of Naradiya Bhakti is that it is toward the innermost reality. Now the second point. The last word of this sutra is Parama Prema Rupa. It is a compound of three words. Parama Prema Rupa. The central word is Prema. Not even Prema. Can anybody define? I would again say Prema is the pull. What is Parama? This Prema, which God is doing us, self-centripetence, has such a force. What are the obstructions? First of all, let us understand. In the field of bhakti, as well as in the field of jnana, no outside force can obstruct us. Please know it for certain. The only obstructing force is I and mine, me and mine. Apart from me and mine and offshoots of me and mine, nobody in the world can obstruct our path to God. And in example, in the Bhagavatam, Shukadeva is narrating to Parikshit that Bhagavan Shri Krishna had promised all the gopis that one day I will give you free joy, infinite joy. According to his promise on the Kartik Purnima day, why that day was chosen? Because it is the clearest sky day, not very cold. He went to Yamuna river, banks of the river, and started playing his flute in the midnight almost. The gopis were in their own houses. Some were busy with their husbands, some with the children, some with the elders. But all the gopis, pulled by that flute, ran from wherever they were, in whatever position they were, they ran to the bank of the Yamuna to meet Sri Krishna. At this point, some gopis' husbands are none other than the sisters-in-law or their elders, mothers-in-law, fathers-in-law, somebody got up when they saw the gopis are getting up and locked their gates from inside. When Shukadeva is narrating this, Parikshit asks him, what fault was theirs? Why they were obstructed? Shukadeva says, King, you have not understood. Those who ran to Shri Krishna, whatever fast they can run, they will take some time to reach him. But those who were obstructed, that moment they reached him in their mind. Nobody can obstruct them. In Goswami Tulsidasa's Ramcharitmanas, describing about Sita is and all that. There is a small couplet in Hindi. Jai ke jai par satya sanegi, so te milat na kachu sandegi. If one has genuine love for somebody, he will get him at all costs. No doubt about it. This is in the Upanishads. Also, this question is raised. For jnana, will devatas not obstruct us? It is said they will try to obstruct, but they cannot. We are trying to become the soul of all humanity. Nobody can obstruct us. So, whether it is jnana or bhakti, there is no outside obstruction. All of you should be absolutely clear on this point. Normally, if we feel obstructed, we blame society, situation, near ones, enemies. Nobody can obstruct us. But we are obstructed. So the obstructing force is mine and mine. I and mine. And various offshoots born of this I and mine. Those who attended Patanjali Sutra classes, Avidya, Asmita, Raga, Dvesh, Avinivesh, all starting from Asmita. Asmita comes from Avidya, but all others come from Asmita, I. Now, this pulling force of the reality, Prema, is such that it will make us cross all the obstacles, that is Parama. It is such a strong force. God can never be obstructed. God is pulling us. Thousands of enemies, let them be there. Thousands of our own mistakes, let them be there. But the force will pull us. And we will go beyond all the obstructions. If the bhakti is real, Narada is expounding real bhakti. And he says, Asmin Parama Prema Rupa. The meaning of Parama is this. That force which pulls us, helping us to cross the obstructions. There are obstructions accepted, but the pulling force, if the bhakti is real, the pulling force will be so strong that it will pull us beyond the obstructions. That is the meaning of the word Parama. Parama Prema. Now the last word, Rupa. Rupa word is important because in the next sutra we will get Swarupa. Rupa means appearance. Appearance not in the sense of false appearance, but our experience. Our experience will be we are being pulled by God. We are being pulled by God strongly will be our experience. Parama Prema Rupa. That means Sadhu, the real bhakti, will appear in our life as being pulled by God with tremendous force. Pulled by innermost reality with a tremendous force. It will appear as this. Now when he says it will appear as this, then we'll ask what it really is. If it will appear as this, what it really is. So, Patanjali's terminology was different. He was using Swarupa for form. Here, Swarupa means real nature. Rupa is the appearance. Swarupa is the real nature. So, in the Sutra number 3, Amrita Swarupa Cha. And just as tu is put in Sanskrit in between but has to be taken before, cha is put in the last but it has to be understood before or in between. And means it will appear as Parama Prema and in its own real nature it is Amrita. No, it is this amrita. Is it some drink? Is it some drug by taking which we will not die? Will become amar? We thought that devatas by taking some nectar they became amar. No devata can become amar. He will become in that position till his punya is exhausted. Then he has to come back. Now about amaratva, let me joke a little. If amaratva means continuing in this life, some great people are asked once upon a time. I do not remember the responses, but I remember the response of Arnold Toynbee, the great historian. He was asked, suppose the infinite life is given to you, will you like it? First immediately he said yes, because I have yet to do a lot of research in history. But then he said, but every year I have to file income tax returns. I don't want. Income tax paying he is not afraid of. Filling the income tax returns is a headache. And every year I have to undertake that. Like that the replies were there. Now I'll give you an example from the Puranas or our old history, if you like it. There was Dronacharya's son Ashwatthama. And he was cursed by Shri Krishna Bhagavan that he will not die. And today what we find? People say, somebody has seen also many people. If you are in a Harisabha or somewhere, and a person approaches you, very dry in appearance, hair absolutely dry, and is asking for some oil, know that is Ashwatthama. So he is begging for oil to put on his head. Do you want to live like that? Condemned to live by Bhagavan because he did great faults. Anyway, so we do not want immortality of the body. But we all desire to have immortality, is a different question. Now this immortality can be only of the Atman. Only when we know, not theoretically know, when we realize that we are not the body, we are not the indriyas or the mind or buddhi or I, we are the Atman real, we are the same, our reality is our being, and that being can never be killed. It is not a part of God, it is God. God is our reality. And nobody can kill God. One funny thing I'll tell you. We say Ishwar is Sarva Shaktiman. He can do whatever he likes. Whatever he likes, not what I and you like. Now, people will say there is one thing which God cannot do. He cannot kill himself. He cannot negate himself, that he cannot do. That is amrita. But now, this amrita has a different meaning, including, it definitely has the meaning that you will realize your own real nature, which is God, which is immortal, but it has an additional meaning. And for that, we have to go to Narada, the student of Sanat Kumar, in the 7th chapter of Chandogya Upanishad. There is the name of God or Brahman or Atman which you are telling. There the name is Bhuma, means infinity. There the name Sanat Kumar is teaching Narada is Bhuma, infinity. And he says, this Bhuma, Tatraiva Sukham, Nalpe Sukham Asti. In the infinite alone there is happiness. There is no happiness in finite things. Now, let us compare the two happinesses. Even in Patanjali Sutra, one day we have talked of that. Any joy which we have in our life today, any joy, First of all, it is impure. We know we are taking the position of a subject in an object that is impure. Every joy which you have in this world is impure. Secondly, it is mixed with pain. There is no joy which is not pain. Patanjali has taught us. Parinama tapa sanskara dukkai gunavritti virodhaccha dukkameva sarvam vivekinam. The end of joy is misery. During joy there is anxiety, that is misery. The joy leaves a sanskara for more, that is a misery. And because different vrittis of the mind collide with each other, there is misery. So joy is impure, joy is mixed with misery, and joy is temporary. No joy which you have in this world is everlasting. Now, visualize, imagine. Today it is imagination, it is reality. The joy of our own real nature, the joy which we get after realizing God, kasmai. Yogatmanda has told kasmai. So our innermost reality, nature is joy. Again, I want to repeat that Patanjali does not know of joy. Sankhya philosophy does not know of joy. But we know that everywhere we say, when you talk of Krishna, we say Satchinanda Krishna. Satchinanda Rama, Satchinanda Shiva. Now this Satchinanda has become a rhetorical word. Satchit Ananda. Shankaracharya has given a beautiful proof. He is asked, how do you know that Atman or Brahman are of the nature of Ananda? Listen to his reply, beautiful. He says, we have seen people of realization who do not use any of the things which normal man uses to get pleasure. We want to get pleasure, we go and play football, cricket. We want to do something with each other. All the things which we use are eating, drinking or something. All the things which a man uses for getting pleasure are absent in them and yet they are happy. The man of realization does not use anything to make himself pleasurable and yet he is happy. That proves that by nature he is happy. This is the way Shankaracharya taught us. So this happiness now is pure, no impurity. No impurity, no bhoga attitude in that. It is a clear bliss. And the misery will not come near it. Even the misery comes, you have to understand this, important point. Don't think that when you realize God, you will not have common cold, you will not have cough, or you will not have pneumonia, or you will not have some anxiety. Gita is telling us, yasme sito na dukkhe na guru na pi vicharyate. That means, when you get that joy, even the big miseries will not trouble you. Let me give an example, two, three examples from Sri Ramakrishna. Once he was in bhava, in union with God in different ways. So, no external consciousness. He fell down. And the bone of his hand did not break, but it had slipped. So, the doctors put a lintel and hung it like that. Now, his disciple, Turiyan Swami, at the time was a boy, Hari, great Vedanti. He heard this and came to see Sri Ramakrishna after 3-4 days. And he asked, Maharaj, how are you? I heard that you fell down and all that. Ramakrishna is not hiding like the hypocrites. He's showing, see how much pain it is. See how much pain it is. And doctors have put bandage. I cannot make it straight also. See. He says, after 5 minutes, Maharaj, let it be, let it be. I see you are immersed in bliss. Sri Ramakrishna says, this fellow has caught me. Understand? Pain is there. In spite of that, joy is there. It is such a depth of joy. It is such a flow of joy that outside miseries do not trouble him. So, another example from Sri Ramakrishna. Bodily, he was suffering from cancer. Many people ask, why cancer? My Guruji used to talk of this cancer as cancer leela. Cancer leela of God. In spite of cancer, he has the same happiness. He is again and again going into samadhi. Can a yogi do like this? Patanjali yogi. In spite of the cancer, again and again he is immersed in his own nature. And when he comes out, he says, where is pain? Where is pain? This we knew. But of late, some years have gone, I came across a book. I recommend that book to all of you. Swami Prabhananji has written Sri Ramakrishna Antya Leela, the description of his last few days. Here he has mentioned that seeing Sri Ramakrishna's pain, his disciples, dear disciples, they used to feel sorry, they used to become depressed. Sri Ramakrishna used to crack such jokes that they used to roll with laughter. So normal outside consciousness, not samadhi. He used to see his disciples have become depressed because of his suffering. He used to crack such jokes with them that they used to roll with laughter. One joke has, nobody has described the joke, but one joke has come out. You remember that? Holy Mother, every day after cooking food, used to carry it to his room. Now she fell down one day. And there was pain in the waist and legs, and she could not climb steps to bring it to him. Sri Ramakrishna is asking Lakshmi Maharaj. Mother used to put a big nose ring in those days. So, what Girish can do? Sri Ramakrishna was a greater dramatist. So, he is showing like that. And showing by signs without talking. Can you carry her in a basket? Let her bring the food. You carry her in the basket. And this, everybody is laughing like anything. In those days, anyone had cancer. Now it is mentioned that he used to crack jokes like this. Throughout the gospel, you will find Master Mahasaya writing, he is now making merry with the boys. What merry, he will never describe, because that is not an ordinary description. So, I will take another example. Swami Vivekananda, when he was in England, he was always smiling. So the religious preachers told him, this is not right, Swami. The religious preacher should be always be gambhir, serious-minded, serious in appearance. Swami said, when I get dyspepsia, sometimes I have serious in appearance. Otherwise, we are the sons of Amrutasya Putra. We are the sons of the joyful God. Why we should not be joyful? So, Amrita means that joy, write down please, 3 points. That joy which is pure, that joy which does not end in misery, that joy which is permanent, that is Amrita. That is what Narada's Guru Sanat Kumar taught him at the end of the 7th chapter in Chandogya Upanishad, toward the end. Bhumaiva Sukham Nalpe Sukham Asti. And there he calls this Bhuma as Amrita. Bhumaiva Amritam Yad Alpam Tadmartyam. Yad Bhuma Tadeva Amritam Yad Alpam Tadmartyam. So immortality coupled with immortal bliss, immortality associate immortality because of the spirit, associated with unbroken joy, the purest joy is Amrita. And this, Narada says, is the nature of this pull. You will experience it as a pull by God, which will make you cross all the obstacles. Parama Prema is the roof of the pull. The inner nature of the pull, Amrita Sarupa Cha, Cha Amrita Sarupa, and its inner nature is Amrita. Not only immortality, but the eternal purest joy. It, what it means now, let us think of. Just now I told about Bhuma and all that. It means, in simple words, Advaita. It means, in simple word, your identification with God. It means, in simple word, that God who is pulling you is one without a second. Anything other than one without a second cannot be infinity. Anything other than one without a second cannot be eternal joy. Anything other than one without a second reality cannot be your real nature. This is the meaning when Narada says, the inner nature of this bhakti is, now you are talking of union and pull and union. Identity. Identity expressed in life becomes union. Love does not mean attraction for each other. Love means identity expressing. When reality is expressed in two, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is telling us. Yajnavalkya is telling Maitri, a husband does not leave wife for the sake of the wife. He loves her because there is a common reality. The wife does not love husband for the sake of husband. She loves because of the Atman which is in common in both of them. And he says, if you love anybody or respect anybody, both words he has used there, taking him to be something other than God, it will cause your downfall. Sarvam tam paradat, ye anyatra atmana sarvam veda. So, what is this? Absolute identity. No difference. This is the nature of bhakti. This is the innermost nature of this pull. In expression, when we feel it as being pulled inside. Understood now? Narada Bhakti still will explain. But Narada Bhakti means being pulled with God with such a force that it will remove, it will take us beyond all obstructions. And really this force is due to pre-existing identity. Now here, let me refer to Sri Ramakrishna. You know, Sri Ramakrishna worshipped Holy Mother as Shodashi. Her age was 18 or 19 hardly. And the goddess is most beautiful when we conceive her of a girl of 16 years age. And that worship Sri Ramakrishna conducted, making Holy Mother sit in front of him. During worship, she entered Samadhi. When Sri Ramakrishna completed worship, he entered Samadhi. So, their unity is not from outside. Both of them reached their own real nature and became united there. enough. So this is Amrita Swarupacha. Now I tried to explain as much as I can, but the thing is very abstract. Narada knows the thing is very, very abstract. So he has his own way of explaining. And what is that way? By showing you the life of a man of realization. What happens to the man who realizes this Amruta? In this way, he'll show us what is the nature of that Amruta. So, Sutra 4, 5, and 6, he uses for this purpose, to show what happens to the person who realizes this Amruta, who realizes this, that which appeared as Parama Prema Rupa, which really was Amruta. What happens to a person who realizes this Amruta? So we go to Sutra 4. Yallabdhva Puman Siddho Bhavati Amruto Bhavati Kripto Bhavati. One each word let us understand. Yallabdhva. Labdhva means, what is the significance of the word Labdha? Labdha means when he gets it. When a person gets this Amruta, that means Amruta is not the result of the action which you do. It comes as a grace of God. It comes to you. You get it. Not that you achieve it. In the next sutra, it talks of achievement. But in this sutra, you get it. Now, this get it is not a chance or luck. Huh? So, next word is Puman. Again, I have to repeat, and people have become very happy, I see. Puman does not mean a man opposed to woman, not at all. Puman means a person who is making effort. You are making effort, but it does not come as a result of your effort, it comes to you. You are doing effort to realize God, and it comes to you. Exact words these people use, rishis. Yallabdhva, obtaining which the man who was personal, let me say, not man, the person who was making the effort, what happens to him? Siddho Bhavati. Siddha is not in the Patanjali sense. Siddha is not a person with so many miraculous powers. Siddha means perfect in life. Siddha means perfect in life. Whether he has realized Amrita or not, we shall see if he sees perfection. Absolute perfection. A guru used to say, absolute divinity is absolute perfection. Yallabdhva Puman Siddho Bhavati. Perfect. We are talking of fulfillment and perfection and purnata. Amruto Bhavati. He says, if you drink Amruta, you will become Amar. But if you drink this Amruta, you will become Amruta itself. You will become that immortal bliss. You will become God. So, we don't want to become God. Whether you want or not is not our question. If the bhakti is real, it will end in your becoming God. This is that divinity, which my guru referred to as absolute divinity, is absolute perfection. And kripto bhavati. If we are hungry and somebody gives us good food, we are satisfied. And after half an hour, we are again hungry. If we get any pleasure in the world, we are happy, satisfied, and again we want that pleasure. This is no satisfaction. Tripti or the sense of satisfaction is different from feel no hunger. Even medically, stomach is filled or not is a different question. They use the word satiety. Satiety is different. Sometimes even eating a little food, but even by a person who loves us, we feel satisfied. Sometimes even after eating so much, stomach is filled, but we are not satisfied. So this is a different faculty of our mind or of our life called satiety. So, if a man has realized Amruta, he is Chiratrupta. He has become satisfied for him. What? Nothing makes him dissatisfied. You can put negatively, you will understand better. Nothing makes him dissatisfied if he has realized that Amruta. So, Narada is telling us these things to make us understand the nature of that Amruta. Sutra 5. Yad prapya na kinchid vanchati na shochati na dveshti na ramate na utsahi bhavati. Prapya means achievement. And why Narada has used this word? To show us that this is the greatest and only real achievement of life. Somebody has become governor, somebody has become IAS officer, and they think they have fulfillment of life. And afterwards, miseries. So nothing in this life gives us the sense of fulfillment, and we are seeking fulfillment. So that prapya means the greatest achievement. Therefore, this word prapya is used. Labdha was, he has got it. Prapya means he has achieved it. And he has used the word achievement because to show that this is the greatest achievement of our life. What happens? This class. Our time is over. I took 4-5 minutes to start somehow. But we will not be able to complete this. Nakinchid vanchati. Monday. Because 6 sutra is also very important. So Monday.
Swamiji.
जयति जगति मायां यस्य कायादवस्ते वचनरचनमेकं केवलं चाकलय्य ध्रुवपदमपि यातो यत्कृपातो ध्रुवोऽयं सकलकुशलपात्रं ब्रह्मपुत्रं नतोऽस्मि. ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति. हरिः ॐ तत्सत् श्रीरामकृष्णार्पणम्.